Hello, good afternoon. I'm Dr. Khatija. Today I want to take the class of endocrine system. Shall we start? Okay, so what is an endocrine system? You must have all read in the physiology department. The endocrine system, it is composed of widely distributed group of organs which work together to maintain the body's metabolic equilibrium or homeostasis. So it's not just one organ, it's a whole system. It's composed of many organs which are working. It's just like an orchestra, they work. And they work to maintain the normal body metabolic equilibrium or homeostasis. So these endocrine organs, they are called the ductless organs also, because they don't have any duct, just like the salivary gland or the lacrimal gland, which have the ducts. But these organs are called as the ductless glands. They secrete their hormones directly into the blood so that they reach to the distant target tissues on which they work. And these hormones, how do they work? Their production is worked out by a feedback inhibition mechanism. So what is the feedback inhibition mechanism? Supposing there are two organs, one is the target organ, one is the primary organ. So how does the primary organ release the hormones? Based on the target organ's hormone status. Okay, so we'll see how it works. Hormones are basically classified based on the mechanism of which they affect or act into the cell. So some of them, they act by binding to the cell surface receptors. Some of them, they bind to the intracellular receptors, not on the cell surface. So we'll see what are these. So peptide hormones, just like the growth hormones or the insulin. And smaller molecules like epinephrine, they work by binding to the cell surface receptors. So what happens when these hormones, they bind to the cell surface receptor? That will lead to the increase in the intracellular messengers. What are these messengers? Cyclic adenosine monophosphate, CNP, inositol 3-phosphates, and ionized calcium. So this is how they work. They bind to the cell surface receptor, which will lead to the increase in the intracellular second messengers. Other hormones which work by binding the intracellular receptors are the lipid soluble hormones, which work through the, how do they work? They pass through the plasma membrane by diffusion to interact with the receptors in the cytosol or the nucleus. Then that resultant hormone receptor complex will bind specifically to the regulatory elements in the DNA. So that's how they affect how the next specific target genes to be working or expressing. Okay, example of the hormones which work through this are the steroid hormones like estrogens and progesterone. Hormones that act by binding the intracellular receptors are, we have seen this slide. Okay. So what are the various diseases of endocrine systems? How do they work out? They can be underproduction of these hormones, or they can be overproduction of these hormones, which are associated with their consequent biochemical and the clinical sequence consequence because of the underproduction or overproduction of these hormones. Next can be the end organ resistance to the effect of the hormone. For example, I'll give you an example like insulin. We say insulin resistance. So that's how the endocrine diseases they do manifest. Okay. Next can be the neoplasms, which can be functional or it can be non-functional. So they can work as a functional by producing overproduction or underproduction of hormones, and also by mass effect. Okay, so how do we assess what is the overproduction, what is the underproduction? How do we know exactly what is happening? So the most important diagnostic tests for these are the biochemical measurements of these hormones. For example, we say T3, T4, TSH, catecholamines, insulin levels. These are all things we can measure biochemically. So these measurements will heavily indicate the endocrine disease. Today, let us see about the pituitary gland. So where is this gland located? Let us see how does this gross specimen looks like. You can see this photograph. So this specimen taken out to the autopsy. The measurement, you can see the diameter up to 1 centimeter of this diameter of the normal pituitary gland. You'll see the description of this photograph. This is a normal pituitary gland, which has the anterior pituitary, which is on the top of the gland. It's called as the adenohypophysis. It's the anterior pituitary. This is the top of the gland. So bottom of the gland is the posterior pituitary, neurohypophysis, which is the smaller portion of the gland at the bottom of each image. Now what is that stalk-like thing? It's a stalk which connects the pituitary to the hypothalamus. So the anterior one is the anterior pituitary. The bottom one is the posterior pituitary. Now this can be seen as a stalk which connects the pituitary to the hypothalamus. Okay. What does this anterior pituitary produce? It produces trophic hormones which stimulate production of hormones from which organs? Organs like thyroid, adrenal, and other glands. So the production or release of the hormones of this pituitary or anterior pituitary is under the control of what? The factors which are produced from the hypothalamus. So we'll see this. So you can see the hypothalamus with the stalk connecting to the pituitary. And there are various hormones produced by the hypothalamus like corticotropin releasing hormone, growth hormone releasing hormone, thyrotropin releasing hormone, or inhibitory hormone factors, or so these are the factors which will control the release of hormones from the anterior and posterior pituitary. Let us see the microscopy. This is the normal anterior pituitary gland. What do you see distinctly here? What kind of cells here? There are various kinds of cells, like blue cells with the blue cytoplasm, cells with the pink cytoplasm. There are cells which are not stained. So when we study about the adenomas of pituitary, you can make a distinct difference between the normal pituitary and the tumor. Tumors, they are especially monomorphic. There's no such difference like pink cells or blue cells. So when we see the tumors, you can identify the difference between the normal pituitary and the tumors. So here the gland is populated by the different distinct types of cells, the basophilic cells or the eosinophilic cells, and non-staining cells, and there is also fine reticular network between the cells. You can make out the fine reticular network here. This is also very important. In tumors, you will not find this fine reticular network in between the cells. Say for example, these pink acidophil cells, they release what I call as growth hormones and prolactin. Basophilic cells are blue or purple cells. They will secrete corticotropin, that's ACTH, thyroid stimulating hormone, gonadotropin, follicle stimulating hormone, luteinizing hormones, okay? So when you have tumors, you can have tumors separately, like tumors coming from these pink cells, tumors coming from these blue cells. Okay, so based on which cell tumor, that cell will be having over or under production of the tumors, so hormones. Let us go on to seeing the pituitary adenomas. The most common cause of the hyperpituitarism is the hormone producing adenoma, which is arising in the anterior lobe. So that's like we have seen what are the cells, pink cells, blue cells, based on which cell, which neoplastic cell is producing, they are named accordingly. So these tumors, based on the size, pituitary adenomas can be called as the microadenomas if they are less than 1 centimeter, or macroadenomas if they exceed 1 centimeter. Let us see something about the pathogenesis. Most common mutation that is seen is in the G protein mutations, which lead to the genomic alterations which will produce pituitary adenomas. So these are second messengers which are affected. So the hormone binds to the cell type receptor. This is the second messenger. And second messenger, cyclic AMP, this will go and cause proliferation, hormone synthesis, secretion. But there's abnormality in this G protein. There's a mutation in this which will lead to the proliferation of cells which will produce adenomas. So 40% of the somatotrope cell adenomas, they bear the GNAS mutation. GNAS mutations are also the G protein mutations, which leads to the activation and persistent generation of cyclic AMP. So what exactly is happening? There's a mutation of the G protein, which leads to the persistent generation and activation of cyclic AMP. That will lead to the unchecked cellular proliferation. This is how the tumors, they form. Okay. In minority of the corticotrope adenomas also, we will see GNAS mutations. One of the history I would like to share, as early as about 1672, Richard Lower, he had done an autopsy on a student, a young student who died suddenly with convulsions within a period of 2 weeks. On autopsy, he found that the ventricles were swollen with blood, and which the blood had gone up to the base of the skull. The olfactory bulbs were all right. They're not at all swollen. That is, there is no abnormality before this pituitary gland. Pituitary gland was completely blocked by. What was the mass? There was a mass like in material seen, which was a viscous and a gelatinous mass about the size of small bean, which had ensued the dropsy of the brain. So this was one of the earliest observations of the pituitary adenomas. The autopsy finding, you can see a mass in this cella tarsica. You can see it's a gelatinous mass which is occupying the whole of the cella tarsica, which is still inside the bony circumference. It has not gone beyond into the brain. You can see this when encapsulated. So this is a well circumscribed mass which is present here in the cella tarsica. This is a pituitary adenoma. So mostly these pituitary adenomas, they are benign. So what do they produce? Either they can produce a mass effect, that is, they'll usually produce a visual problem because of pressure on the optic chiasma, or it can produce headaches, or they can be production of hormones such as prolactin or ACTH. Whichever cell is producing the adenoma, that overproduction is seen. Another gross specimen. Here you can see this is a massive adenoma which has gone beyond the confines of the cella tarsica, and it has distorted the underlying brain. This is a non-functioning adenoma. So what exactly happens? If it is a functioning adenoma, because of the production of hormones, the patient will have some complaints and will go to the doctor early. And these non-functioning adenomas, the patient is asymptomatic, is not have any problem according to like if it were the functioning adenoma. These are non-functioning adenoma, this will present late for the patient. So by the time patient presents, it will be grossly enlarged and it's gone into the overlying brain. So we can describe this as a well circumscribed soft lesion. They can be small tumors which will be confined to the salatorsica. 30% of the cases, there will be non-encapsulated and they will be infiltrating the adjacent brain or the bone, the dura, and sometimes into the brain itself. Foci of hemorrhage and necrosis is commonly seen in the larger adenomas. So why there is the occurrence of hemorrhage and necrosis? Because of the increased vascularity requirement. If there is no vessels or new vessel formation, will lead to the hemorrhage formation and necrosis in the larger adenomas. Now you can see the microscopy of pituitary adenomas. See, this is a striking difference between a normal pituitary and a pituitary adenoma. See, there is a monomorphism of these cells. That means this is arising from one type of cell, either pink cells or the blue cells. Okay, so there is no admixture of the cells, and also there is an absence of reticulin network. So microscopy will define the pituitary adenomas as being composed of uniform polygonal cells, which are arranged in sheets, cords, or they are arranged in either papillae, sheets, or cords. And the supporting connective tissue is very sparse. You can see the nuclei of the cells will be uniform or less pleomorphic. So the cellular monomorphism and absence of significant reticular network. That's what I have been discussing before. Pituitary adenomas, we distinguish it from the non-neoplastic adjacent pituitary parenchyma. So here there is not much description of the capsule. Here there is just distinction between the cells, the monomorphic cells, and the variety of the cells. The mitotic activity is usually scanty. Cytoplasm can be acidophilic, basophilic, or chromophobic, based on which cell type is producing this tumor. And by seeing the histology, we cannot make out the functional status, whether it is producing the hormone or not. Sometimes these adenomas, they also harbor P53 mutations. If there is a P53 mutation, there is a brisk mitotic activity and higher proliferation rates. And that will be designated or called as the atypical adenomas. And the P53 mutation will give them a potential for aggressive behavior. Usually adenomas, they do not have P53 mutations. What is the mutation seen in the pituitary adenomas? It is the G protein mutation. But some of them show P53 mutation, which will give the tumor the aggressive behavior. Okay. So let us see some of the functioning adenomas. First example is the prolactin producing leptotroph adenomas. This is the most frequent type of the hyperfunctioning pituitary adenoma. So prolactin is mostly demonstrated within the, how do we know? We can demonstrate by doing the immunohistochemical technique. So we know the hormones produced by the pituitary. Based on just a morphology, it is little difficult to say which is the type. So we can do an ISC to find out what is the cell contents. Clinically, if we take history, hyperprolactinemia will produce symptoms like amenorrhea, galactorrhea, loss of libido, and infertility. So these are the symptoms the patient can present with amenorrhea, galactorrhea. So based on this history, we can try to find out whether there is an adenoma whether there is a prolactin secreting adenoma. We can do a biopsy and we can get a immunohistochemistry done on that particular biopsy. Second type is the somatotrope adenomas. They are the eosinophil, acidophil adenomas. Okay. So they are the growth hormone secreting somatotrope adenomas. So they are the adenomas which are producing growth hormones. This is the next second most common functioning pituitary adenoma. So usually these are small, but they produce symptoms. So in adults they produce acromegaly. In children they produce gigantism. So in children they produce gigantism. Okay, so here you can see the gigantism. It will produce the increased body tissues like hands and feet. They will be very much enlarged. The body figure itself will be very much enlarged. Next is the corticotrophic cell adenomas. They produce excess ACTH. They are the corticotrophic adenomas. This will lead to, if there is excess ACTH, it will lead to hypersecretion of cortisol from the adrenal gland. So what is the role of ACTH? It will go and activate the adrenal gland, because of which there is increased production of cortisol. This cortisol will produce Cushing syndrome. Then the next, when we leave the adrenal gland, we will see the most common cause of Cushing syndrome is a corticotrophic cell adenoma. So you should be able to link the two. So most important cause of Cushing syndrome of hypercortisolism is the corticotrophic cell adenomas. Maybe this can be one of the questions that I'll be producing. What is the most common cause of the Cushing syndrome? Now we can test a PAS stain for this. This is because of the accumulated glycosylated ACTH protein. This is glycosylated, because of which we can do the PAS stain. So mostly these corticotrophic cell adenomas are called as the micro adenomas. They are very small adenomas, but they are producing hormones. Okay, here we finish the anterior pituitary tumors, and let us go to the posterior pituitary syndromes. Hypothalamic neurons, they produce two peptides, that is the antidiuretic hormone and oxytocin. So clinically important is the antidiuretic hormone overproduction or underproduction. So what is it? We'll see. So antidiuretic hormone deficiency, as you know, the word antidiuretic hormone, antidiuresis, there is no diuresis. So what is the meaning of no diuresis? There is no increased excessive urination. But if there is a deficiency of antidiuretic hormone, what happens? There is excessive urination called urea, which occurs because of inability of the kidney to reabsorb water properly from the urine. There is excretion of large volume of dilute urine with an appropriately low specific gravity. So what is the specific gravity of urine in case of diabetes insipidus? That's another question for you all. You all will give me answer in the Schoology chat for endocrinology. So there are whatever questions I have been posting, please give me answer in the Schoology chat app. Okay. So what was the question? Question is, what is the specific gravity? It says inappropriately low specific gravity. So what is the specific gravity of urine in diabetes insipidus is the question. What exactly happens? The serum sodium and osmolality are increased as a result of excessive renal loss of free water. So consequently, it will result in thirst and polydipsia. The patient will be thirsty and always drinking water. So excess of water drinking, excess of urination. Then there is a syndrome called syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone. That means there is excess production of antidiuretic hormone. So what happens? This is the opposite. So there is a reduction of excessive amount of free water. So there is extra water in our body that will lead to hyponatremia. Clinically, the patient will be presenting with hyponatremia, there will be cerebral edema with resulted neurological dysfunction. So what happens, although there is total body water is increased, blood volume will remain the same and peripheral edema does not develop. So here, what is the more important thing to remember? In SIADH, there is hyponatremia. So here we'll finish off the pituitary, anterior pituitary, posterior pituitary. This is a summary you can go through. So most common cause of hypopituitarism is the anterior lobe pituitary adenoma. Macroadenomas are more than 1 cm diameter, microadenomas are less than 1 cm diameter. They can be functional or non-functioning adenomas. Macroadenomas are functioning adenomas, they are associated with the distinct endocrine signs and symptoms. There's a mutation seen in the GNAS gene. And the morphological microscopic picture of these adenomas is the cellular pleomorphism and there is absent reticular network. Prolactinomas, you will see clinically as amenorrhea, galactorrhea and infertility. Growth hormone tumors, adenomas, the patient will present with gigantism seen in children. In adults, you will see acromegaly and there will be impaired glucose tolerance and diabetes mellitus. Corticotrophs and adenomas will be producing Cushing syndrome and hyperpigmentation. And all the adenomas, especially the non-functioning adenomas, they can be associated with the mass effect and hypopituitarism. Thank you. So I will continue with the next topic of adrenal glands. After a 5 minute break. Okay, shall we start adrenal glands? So what are these adrenal glands? Where are they located? What is anatomy? So this is the kidney. So they are just located above the kidney. Okay. You can see the color of this organ. This looks just like the adipose tissue here. So this is also yellow. This is also yellow. Perimetric fat. So this also looks like a perimetric fat, but they are actually the endocrine organs. So once removed, they look like this. Something like a triangular shaped organs. So they have got cortex and medulla in cut section. That's cortex and medulla. The cortex itself has got three layers. You can remember by the word GFR. GFR is a glomerulosa, fasciculata, and reticula. So GFR. So these are three zones. So just below the capsule is a zona glomerulosa, which secretes mineralocorticoids. There's a zona fasciculata, which secretes glucocorticoids. In this layer, they'll be storing the lipids. This is the biggest layer among all the three. Then there is a zona reticularis, which secretes androgens and small amount of glucocorticoids. You can see this word is very important whenever it comes to production of tumor, production of the hormones. Sometimes there is because of excessive ACTH, because of the less production of the ACTH, there is an atrophy of the cortex glands. But this zona reticularis area is not dependent upon the ACTH. So there will be overproduction of glucocorticoids from this area in such situations. Histology, you see what is the zona glomerulosa composed of. It is the one that is lying just beneath the adrenal capsule and appears just like a small clusters of cells, few cells. They are the well-defined cells. They have got less cytoplasm. Very lipid poor area. It's only about 15% of cortical volume. I'll show you the photograph of this. Okay, so this particular thing is the zona glomerulosa. Okay, this is the zona fasciculata. So this layer is very little, 15% of the whole thing. This is lying within the capsule, zona glomerulosa. So it has clusters which look like small clusters and short trabecula of well-defined cells. Next is zona fasciculata. It's a middle layer. It's a broad band, which is about, which has cells, distinct cells that are arranged in pods, which are two cell wide. Cytoplasm of this cell is abundant, which has lipid vacuoles. And the centrally located nucleus, which can be indented, which may resemble just like a lipoblast. This constitute about 70 to 80% of the cortical volume. So this is a zona fasciculata where you can see the cells are rich in the lipids. Cells are rich in the lipids. The nucleus is centrally located. Okay, this is zona fasciculata. The whole appearance of the adrenal gland is yellowish because of the presence of these lipid laden cells. Next is zona reticularis, which is the innermost layer. This has haphazardly arranged cells, and these cells are much smaller than the zona fasciculata cells. They have granular and mesenchymatic cytoplasm. These cells have lipofuscin in their cytoplasm and very little lipids. So this is thinner than the other two layers. So here you can see the zona reticularis, haphazardly arranged cells, and there's less lipids. and there is like the fission in the cytoplasm. Adrenal medulla, which is having chromatin cells, and they secrete catecholamines, mainly the epinephrine. Okay, again, the disease of adrenal cortex is also because of the hyper and hypofunctioning. So because of the hyperfunctioning, because of the hyperfunctioning of cortisol, we have Cushing syndrome. Excess of mineralocorticoids will lead to hyperaldosteronism. Excess of androgens will lead to adrenogenital or virilizing syndromes. So what is this Cushing syndrome? So there are various causes that can be linked to the Cushing syndrome. So basically, patient has elevated glucocorticoid levels. So it can be an exogenous corticoids, that is, we are taking steroids from outside for many conditions, for iatrogenic, we give steroids to the patient, just like rheumatoid arthritis and so many other conditions, we give steroids to the patient. So it's an exogenous steroid that we are giving to the patient that will also lead to the Cushing syndrome. And there are certain endogenous causes. Three more most common important disorders are pituitary disease. We have seen just now in the pituitary, where there is a tumors which are causing hypersecretion of ACTH, which will lead to Cushing syndrome. The next is the ectopic ACTH production by non-pituitary neoplasm. We'll see what they are. Or it can be a primary adrenocortical neoplasm. So the one picture you can remember, it's the causes of Cushing syndrome, iatrogenic, we're giving medicines. It can be a pituitary, excess production of ACTH, tumors which are producing ACTH, which will lead to adrenal hyperplasia. You can see the adrenal hyperplasia, which will cause more cortisol. Now there is adrenal Cushing syndrome because of this, either tumors or they can be a nodular hyperplasia, which will lead to excess cortisol. Or they can be non-pituitary tumors, example, lung cancer. This can be a paraneoplastic syndrome. Okay, paraneoplastic Cushing syndrome, which will lead to adrenal hyperplasia, leads to excessive cortisol. So what is this paraneoplastic lung cancer? Small cell carcinoma will produce ACTH. This will produce adrenal hyperplasia. This will cause excessive cortisol, which will lead to Cushing syndrome. So if you want to divide the etiology, we can name it as the ACTH dependent and ACTH independent disease. So let us see the pituitary hypothalamic diseases. So the Cushing's disease is called as Cushing's disease, which is seen in 70% of the cases. That means the cause of the Cushing's disease is 70% of the cases, it is a pituitary disease. It is four times more common in women than men. It occurs in young adulthood. And the majority of the causes is the ACTH producing microadenomas. Okay, or they can be corticotrop cell hyperplasia or tumors. Okay. They can be ectopic production. We have seen already non-pituitary tumors, example, small cell carcinoma of the lung. Now coming to primary adrenal neoplasms, it can be adrenal adenoma or carcinoma. Okay, so in some of the cases, only the primary cortical hyperplasia, as we have seen because of the endogenous Cushing syndrome, that can also cause ACTH independent Cushing syndrome. Here, the adrenals are functioning autonomously. So Cushing syndrome, it can be caused by the unilateral adrenocortical neoplasms, which can be benign or malignant. Okay, so there can be two varieties: micronodules of varying sizes up to 3 cm, or micronodules 1 to 3 mm. So what are the biochemical hallmarks of adrenal Cushing syndrome? Is the elevated cortisol level and low levels of serum ACTH. So if you want to establish the etiology of Cushing syndrome, what we should do? We should first measure plasma ACTH level. So it can be less than 5 picogram per milliliter, or it can be more than 15 picogram per milliliter. So here we are measuring it on the two different occasions. Okay. So based on this flowchart, you can actually find out whether it is an adrenal adenoma. We can do imaging, CT scan finding to find out what is the disease. Okay. So it can be high ACTH or a low ACTH. So what is our hallmark, biochemical hallmark? Elevated level of cortisol and low level of serum ACTH. So then that will lead us to a diagnosis towards adrenal cause of the Cushing syndrome. Okay. So the main lesions actually which cause the Cushing syndrome are found either in pituitary gland or in the adrenal gland. Okay, so what do we see in pituitary? This is a Krug hairline change where the ACTH producing cells in the adrenal pituitary, they are replaced by the homogeneous lightly basophilic material because of accumulation of intermediate keratin filaments in the cells. In the adrenal glands, based on the causes, what can be the reason? Like it can be a diffuse hyperplasia of the adrenal gland, it can be a cortical atrophy, it can be a macronodular or micronodular hyperplasia, it can be an adenoma or a carcinoma. Okay, so what is a diffuse hyperplasia? Both the glands are enlarged, each weighing up to 30 grams. So here you can see this is diffuse hyperplasia. Here the both the glands are involved. Enlarged. If there is tumor, it will be just a unilateral one. So adrenal gland cortex is diffusely thickened and will be variably nodular. The yellow color of diffusely hyperplastic glands, it will derive from the presence of lipid-rich glands. Lipid-rich cells which appear vacuolated under microscope. Okay. So under hyperplasia, you will be seeing diffuse thickening of yellow colored or vacuolated cells. In primary cortical hyperplasia, we have got macronodules. You will see one of the photographs of this. The cortex is almost always replaced by macronodules or pigmented micronodules. And this pigment is believed to be the lipofuscin, which is you all know what Verruntar pigment. Yeah, this is one of the gross examples. Can see this is a pigmented lesion in the cortex. Okay, so there are prominent pigmented nodules. And what is this pigmented nodules here? We are seeing lipofuscin pigment. Functional adenomas or carcinomas of the adrenal cortex. They are morphologically similar to non-functioning adrenal adenomas. So functional adenomas are also similar to the non-functioning adenomas. They are all the benign and the malignant lesions. They are both common in the women in their 30s to 50s. And these adenomas, they appear as the yellow tumors, which will weigh up to 30 grams. And they are thin or well-developed capsules. These adenomas, they are surrounded by well-developed capsules. In the pituitary, we have seen there are no such thing as capsules, but here they have well-developed capsules. On microscopic examination, you can see these cells, which are looking similar to the zona fasciculata cells. So these adenomas are solitary, single, there was a subscribed lesion. Functional status cannot be predicted from its gross or microscopic appearance. Similar to the pituitary, we cannot say what is the functional status, how much of them they are working. So what do these cells look like? These cells are vacuolated and because of the presence of intracytoplasmic lipids. And there is mild nuclear pleomorphism. Mitotic activity in necrosis is not seen. Here is a gross. You can see a yellow colored benign lesion which is well circumscribed. And here you can see monomorphic cells, some of them having lipids, and there's not much of mitotic activity in this. So these are adrenocortical adenomas. Carcinomas which are associated with Cushing syndrome, they are usually bigger or larger than the adenomas. These tumors are non-encapsulated. So benign tumors are adenomas that are encapsulated. Malignant lesions are non-encapsulated. Now the adenomas, they weigh up to 30 grams. But malignant tumors, they'll weigh from 200 to 300 grams in weight. And they have all the anaplastic features of any malignancy. Benign tumors, they do not have any anaplastic characters, but malignant tumors do have the anaplastic characteristics of cancer. So, if we have a functioning tumor, both malignant and benign, what happens to the adjacent adrenal cortex and other contralateral adrenal glands? They all become atrophic. Why they become atrophic? Because of the functioning tumors, there is less of ACTH which is coming from the pituitary. So there is no ACTH coming from the pituitary, the adjacent normal adrenal cortex, they become atrophic. Okay, because of the suppression of endogenous ACTH by high cortisol levels. This is one of the examples of Cushing syndrome, where you can see moon facies, buffalo hump, and you can see very prominent abdominal tract. You can see a lemon on stick appearance with thin extremities and increased fat content in the various parts of the body. We'll see what is primary hyperaldosteronism. The most common cause of this is the benign adenoma. Sometimes it can be idiopathic, which will lead to increased aldosterone level. So what is the effect of this aldosterone? It will have its effect on the potassium, movement of potassium into the tubules, and this excreted. Once the potassium is excreted, sodium is reabsorbed, and once the sodium is reabsorbed, it will lead to hypertension. More sodium in the blood, that will lead to hypertension. So what is the most common presentation of primary hyperaldosteronism is the hypertension in the patient. What is an adrenogenital syndrome? They are a group of disorders caused because of the excessive androgens. It can be primary gonadal disorder or severe primary adrenal disorders. So these are the various congenital adrenal hyperplasias. Congenital adrenal hyperplasia, which is a group of autosomal recessive disorders because of the defect in the hereditary defect in the enzyme which is involved in the adrenal steroid biosynthesis, which will lead to particularly the cortisol. Okay, most important is the deficiency of the enzyme 21-hydroxylase. So it will have a virilizing effect and they can have a bilateral hyperplasia of the adrenal cortex. So something like hypo or insufficiency adrenal, till now we have seen hyperfunctioning. Now we are seeing the hypofunctioning. There is a primary adrenal disease, primary hypoadrenalism, or decreased stimulation of adrenals because of ACTH deficiency. Okay, so it can be acute. If it is acute, it is called as the adrenal crisis. If it is chronic, it is called as the Addison's disease. So Addison's disease is a chronic adrenal insufficiency. Now, adrenal insufficiency is occurring because of either the adrenal gland itself or because of the less ACTH which is produced by the Causes of adrenal insufficiency, it can be acute, something like Waterhouse Friderichsen syndrome, or it can be a sudden withdrawal of the long-term corticosteroid therapy. That's the reason we don't give a sudden withdrawal. We taper the end use of this. Once we have to stop corticosteroids, we have to taper the dose. It's not a sudden withdrawal. Otherwise, it will result in a sudden adrenal insufficiency. So you have to remember this always. And there's a chronic, it can be because of the autoimmune adrenalitis or infections like tuberculosis, AIDS, fungal infection, or it can be systemic diseases like sarcoidosis, hemochromatosis. Systemic amyloidosis, which can have an effect on the adrenal gland itself and produce the destruction of the gland, leading to adrenal insufficiency. So these are summary you can read. Coming to neoplasms. So functional adenomas are most commonly associated with hyperandrogenism and Cushing syndrome. Organizing neoplasm is more likely to be a carcinoma. Okay, so among the three, virilizing neoplasm is more likely to be a carcinoma. Other ones can be a benign tumors. Most cortical adenomas, they do not cause hyperfunctioning. Sometimes they can be seen as an adrenal incidentalomas. Incidentalomas are incidental findings of tumors, maybe during autopsy or maybe during abdominal imaging for another unrelated cause. Incidentally, you will find a small tumor-like lesion which is present in the adrenal gland. So it is called as the adrenal incidentaloma. So what will they appear as? Cut section will be more commonly yellow to brown color because of presence of lipids. Okay. So they will not be more than 1 to 2 centimeter diameter. Microscopically, you will see cells which are similar to the cells seen in the adrenal cortex. Sometimes we can see pleomorphism encountered in the benign tumors. And it's not a reliable marker of malignancy. It's called endocrine pleomorphism, which is seen in many of the endocrine organs like thyroid, adrenals, which is a benign entity. Let us see adrenocortical carcinomas. They are the rare neoplasms that can occur at any age. So this is very important. These are rare neoplasms. It can be seen in childhood also. There are two associated inherited causes of these carcinomas. These are the Li-Fromani syndrome and Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome. So these are the inherited causes of adrenal cortical carcinoma. So most of the cases, what are these carcinomas look like? They are large, invasive lesions. They efface the native adrenal gland. That means these carcinomas, they totally erode the structure, normal structure, and they invade the native structures. Cut section will appear as a variegated surface. What is the meaning of variegated surface? It can have different areas. It can have cystic area. It can have areas of necrosis or hemorrhage. So this is called as a variegated appearance. And these are poorly demarcated lesions. Can you see this? There are the areas of hemorrhage, necrosis. This carcinoma, it dwarfs the kidney. It actually reduces the size of the kidney and compresses the upper pole. As you can see, there are areas of hemorrhage and necrosis. Okay. So this is the kidney. You can see the kidney here. Actually compressing the upper pole of the kidney. Okay, understood? This is a large carcinoma, adrenal carcinoma. Microscopically, you see well-defined cells which resembles the cells which are seen similar to the adrenal cortical adenomas. There can be pleomorphic cells which can be difficult to distinguish them from the undifferentiated carcinoma, which are metastatic to the adrenal gland. So we can see metastatic tumors which can come from other organs, which are coming to the adrenal glands, so these cells are difficult to distinguish whether they are the primary of the adrenal gland or they are the metastatic carcinomas. Okay. How do they invade? They have invasion through the adrenal vein, vena cava, and the lymphatics. And the regional lymph nodes, periaortic lymph nodes, are commonly involved. And they do have a distant metastasis spread to the lungs and other viscera. So these are very notorious malignancies. But one thing is bone metastasis is very unusual. Median survival of the patient is about 2 years. So what one thing to note is carcinomas metastatic to adrenal cortex are significantly more frequent than a primary adrenocortical carcinoma. So any tumors which we are finding in the adrenal cortex, more common is a metastatic carcinoma than a primary carcinoma. So here it is a microscopic picture of adrenal carcinoma. There is marked anaplasia. What's the meaning of anaplasia? There is not much differentiation into a particular cell type. So adrenal medulla is populated by the cells derived from the neural crest cells, chromatin cells, and their supporting cells. They are called as the substantacular cells. Chromatin cells are so named because of the brown color after exposure to the potassium dichromate. If they are being exposed to potassium dichromate, these cells, they become brown to black in color. That's why they are called as chromaffin cells, because of the color. And they secrete catecholamines. What do they secrete? Chromaffin cells, they secrete catecholamines in response to signals from the preganglionic nerve fibers in the sympathetic nervous system. So what are the most important diseases in adrenal medulla are the neoplasms. What are these neoplasms? Both neural neoplasms and the neoplasms from the chromaffin cells. Neural neoplasms, we have neuroblastomas and more mature ganglion cell tumors. Tumors from chromaffin cells, we have got pheochromocytomas. You have learned about neuroblastomas before. So what are pheochromocytomas? They are neoplasms which are composed of chromaffin cells, which release catecholamines. They are especially important because these tumors, they are a cause of surgically correctable form of hypertension. So how do the patients present? The patients of pheochromocytomas, they present with hypertension, and these form a correctable form, surgically correctable form of hypertension. Once the tumor is removed, the reason for hypertension is being removed. So there is a rule of 10 to pheochromocytoma. What is this rule of 10? So 10% of pheochromocytomas, they are extra adrenal. Example, carotid body or the organ of Zucker-Candle. There the tumor is called as a paraganglioma. They are not called as a pheochromocytoma there. 10% of adrenal pheochromocytomas, they are bilateral. 10% of adrenal pheochromocytomas, they are malignant, not many. And although they are associated, the hypertension represents a serious and a potentially lethal complication of even the benign tumors. So frank malignancy is somewhat more common in tumors arising in the extra adrenal sites. So in the extra adrenal site, frank malignancy is more common. So 10% of adrenal pheochromocytomas are not associated with hypertension. And 90% of that present with hypertension, 2/3 they have got paroxysmal episodes with sudden rise in the blood pressure and palpitation, which can be fatal. So these are all the various rule of 10%. 10% are extra adrenal, 10% are bilateral, 10% are malignant, 10% are associated with hypertension, 90% of them will have paroxysmal episodes of sudden rise in blood pressure and palpitation. 25% of them will have a germline mutation in one of the at least 6 known disease genes. Few of them are RET gene, which causes type 2 Men syndrome, NF1, which causes neurofibromatosis type 1, VHL, which causes the von Hippel-Lindau disease. So these are the abnormality in the germ line mutations. So how do they appear? They are small in size, they are well circumscribed, and they are confined to the adrenal gland. Sometimes they are large, hemorrhagic, or they can weigh several kilograms. Okay, so there is much variation in the size. It can be as small and confined to the adrenal gland, or it can be large, hemorrhagic, with having several kilograms of weight. Cut section, it should be yellow color, and the well-defined lesion will compress the adjacent adrenal gland. Larger areas will be hemorrhagic, necrotic, and cystic, and typically it will erode the adrenal glands. Similarly, if we put this fresh tissue in potassium dichromate solution, the tumor will turn dark brown, because of which it is called as a chromaffin in our previous slides. So this is one of the diagnostic tests. See one of the graphs. How it is? Tumor is enclosed within an attenuated cortex. Attenuated is the thinned out cortex, and there are areas of hemorrhage. You can see variegated areas of hemorrhage. Here it's a comma shaped normal adrenal gland which is pushed towards the bottom. Microscopically, they are composed of polygonal to spindle shaped chromaffin cells and their supporting cells, which are substantacular cells. What is the microscopy of chromocytoma? They are polygonal to spindle-shaped chromaffin cells along with supporting cells. They are compartmentalized into small nests by a rich vascular network. Cytoplasm of these neoplastic cells often has fine granular appearance. They are highlighted by a variety of silver stains. So, we can use a silver stain to demonstrate the granularity of the cytoplasm of these neoplastic cells. What is this granularity? Because of catecholamines. The granularity is because of the catecholamines, which can be demonstrated using the silver stain. So electron microscopy can be done to find out about the membrane bound electron dense granules containing catecholamines. The nuclei of this cells are pleomorphic. This will show capsular and vascular invasion. Some of it can also be encountered in the benign lesion. So definitive diagnosis of malignancy is based on the presence of metastasis. So just to say, just to see the organ and describe about malignancy, it is really very difficult, because even in benign lesion, we can see cellular pleomorphism. As I have told you before, in pituitary also, that there will be some amount of cellular pleomorphism which is seen in the benign lesion and normal lesion also. It is all as the endocrine atypia. So based on this, we cannot describe a malignancy. So to say that a pheochromocytoma is malignant, we should be able to demonstrate metastasis. Before that, we cannot say that it is a malignant lesion. These may involve the regional lymph nodes as well as the distant sites like liver, lung, and bones. Here you can see a pheochromocytoma microscopy. The nest of cells, these are the nest of cells. Okay. This is having abundant cytoplasm. So presence of abundant cytoplasm is something which we do not see in a malignancy. Sometimes it is common to see some bizarre cells, just like this one in the center. This is a bizarre looking cell, but this is a benign tumor. So to say these cells are very difficult to say whether they are benign or malignant based on this feature, whether because they have got less pleomorphism in the nuclei, abundant cytoplasm, or pleomorphism, if it is present, it can be present in a benign tumor. So to say it is a malignant, we have to say that we have to demonstrate presence of metastasis. So in 90% of the patients, we will be seeing hypertension in a patient of pheochromocytoma. That is the paroxysmal episode with abrupt precipitous elevation of blood pressure with tachycardia, palpitation, headache, sweating, tremor, and a sense of apprehension. The patient will be apprehended what is exactly the problem. So it is the precipitous elevation in the blood pressure which is more important clinical features. Surgery of this neoplasm, it's a very difficult one because we have to be very careful. If there is a spillage of this cell, the patient can go into an adrenal crisis, which is very difficult to manage. Neuroblastomas, as you have seen before already, it's the most common extracranial solid tumor of the childhood, and they're seen during the first 5 years of the life and maybe occurring during the infancy. They can occur anywhere in the sympathetic nervous system, occasionally within the brain. They are most commonly seen in the abdomen. So the majority of tumors will be arising in the adrenal medulla or retroperitoneal sympathetic gland ganglia. Most neuroblastomas are sporadic, or they can be familial. Cases can also be have also been described. So the description of neuroblastomas are already described in childhood tumors. We'll just see the microscopy. Homerized globules. They are the small round cell blue tumors. Neuroblasts, sometimes they'll be differentiated or they'll be undifferentiated. They look small to medium. So with salt and pepper chromatin, they're elongated shape. They can have a distinct nucleus or some small amount of cytoplasm. That is vague cytoplasmic bodies. So here you can hardly make up the cytoplasmic bodies. The homerite, they are called as the small round blue cell tumors. The homerite rosettes. So how are the nuclei with the salt and pepper chromatin? Cytoplasm is very indistinct. So there are some very few slides on multiple endocrine neoplasias. We'll just finish off quickly. The men syndromes, inherited, caused by the proliferative lesions. They can be hyperplasias, there can be adenomas, there can be carcinomas of multiple endocrine organs. So they can occur at a younger age group. They will arise in multiple organs. Even in one organ, there can be multifocal tumors. Or they can be a stage of endocrine hyperplasia, which is involving the cell of origin. So the example, patient with MEN2, they almost invariably demonstrate T-cell hyperplasia in the thyroid parenchyma, which is adjacent to the medullary thyroid carcinoma. That is, patient will have medullary thyroid carcinoma. In adjacent area, there will be T-cell hyperplasia. And these tumors are mostly more aggressive and they recur. Say like men type 1, multiple endocrine neoplasia type 1, it is caused by the germline mutation in MEN1 tumor suppressor gene. It encodes for a protein called menin. The MEN1 tumor suppressor gene mutations are seen. What are the organs involved? 3 P's. Parathyroid, pancreas, and pituitary. Hyperparathyroidism is seen where there is hyperplasia and adenomas. And there are endocrine tumors of pancreas, that is Zollinger Resistance Syndrome, associated with gastrinomas, hypoglycemias, insulinomas. There is pituitary tumor, that is prolactin secreting microglia, which are seen in MEN1. Then MEN2. It has got a red proto oncogene mutation on chromosome number 10, Q11.2. What are the lesions seen in thyroid? We see medullary carcinoma thyroid, In adrenal medulla, we'll see adrenal pheochromocytomas. Parathyroid, there will be parathyroid gland hyperplasia, which will produce primary hyperparathyroidism. Men type 2B, 2B, 2A and 2B. So 2A is an autosomal dominant pattern. 2B, there's a single amino acid change in the red. And it is more aggressive in men type 2A and so patients usually develop medullary thyroid carcinomas, which are more multifocal and more aggressive than compared to type 2A. So in type 2B, we have more aggressive medullary thyroid carcinomas and pheochromocytomas. And extra adrenal manifestations, they are present more in men type 2B. They include ganglioneuromas of mucosal sites, marfanoid habitus of the axial skeleton that will resemble the marfan syndrome. So references, Dobbins, thank you. So here we finish the two topics of pituitary and adrenal glands. So I would like to pose some questions in the Schoology app, which we will be discussing in the next coming classes. So I shall be finishing my class now. Okay, thank you. हेलो सलाम आपको।